So in this part, I will discuss about the performance-based design process, and I will just introduce this process and some of the skills and methods which are required to undergo this process. As I mentioned in the start also that this lecture will just introduce the performance-based design and assessment methodology. You are not going to become an expert in PBD or performance-based assessment after this lecture. It is just introducing the idea. So as I mentioned in the last session that the performance-based design process goes beyond the code-based design, and the code-based design primarily serves as an input into the performance-based design. The linear elastic model which you analyze for the purpose of calculating seismic demands for the code-based design, that analysis will give you a starting design, and then you can use those capacities which are provided as a result of code-based design to formulate what we call as a non-linear computer model, which is more realistic, which is going to give you the real seismic demands and the actual damage of the structure. So you go one step beyond that from linear elastic analysis, which is recommended by the traditional building codes. You formulate the non-linear model of your building and you analyze that, and you extract the results for that non-linear analysis. You process them, and using that process, you interpret the results for any meaningful design decision making in terms of structural performance. So this is the overall process. Generally, the traditional seismic design practice is up to this point. It doesn't go beyond the linear elastic analysis. If we look at a more detailed view of this whole process, it will be like this, that you have, for example, architectural drawings or some preliminary design or detailing. You use that to construct what is called as the linear elastic model, and you perform the code-based design at the design basis earthquake level. And you can use the traditional force-based design procedures to come up with the design seismic demands, and then you provide the capacities according to those demands. The traditional design practice is up to this point. In PBD, what you do is that you go beyond that and you determine the true capacities of all structural elements based on the initial design which you have done already. So you may use the code-based design as a starting design or any other rational approach to come up with the starting design. And then you can determine the true capacities of all structural elements. For example, the yield moments of all the beams, the axial force and interaction and yield moments for all the columns and shear walls, for example, the complete nonlinear force deformation behavior. So at this stage, I would write that force versus deformation behavior, and those behaviors will be inelastic, obviously, because they will be complete behaviors. Inelastic behavior for each action in each element. So each action, for example, shear, flexure, axial load, and for each element also. So each action and each element. This is a detailed process. And as asked by one of the students that the international guidelines or different performance-based documents, reports, they help us in calculating the capacities, the detailed force deformation, inelastic capacities of all the actions and all the elements. We use that actual capacities or the nonlinear curves. For example, at material level, the primary action deformation curve is the stress-strain behavior. Stress-strain behavior at material level. So one approach there is that you can define the stress-strain curve, the true nonlinear curve for each element, for each material in each element, and you can define it to construct what we call as the nonlinear model of the structure. All the materials in that model will follow their corresponding nonlinear stress-strain curves. Another approach can be that you define the nonlinear behavior, not at material level but at the cross-section level. And that cross-section level, for example, in case of flexural behavior, it can be moment versus curvature relationship, the primary action deformation curve. And another approach can be that you define the flexural behavior, nonlinear flexural behavior, right at the member level. In that case, it will be moment versus rotation curve, and that will also be the real nonlinear curve that will be at member level. So all of these kind of curves are called action deformation curves, action versus deformation curves. So these kind of curves basically give us the capacity of different material, cross sections or elements, that at what point that particular element or material will yield, and then what will be its post yield behavior. So these are the capacities basically for different materials, cross section or members. And these capacities will be the function of the initial design which we used, which we may have done from code based design. So whatever capacity we provide, whatever reinforcement amount or cross-sectional sizes or shear reinforcement, for example, or the amount of confinement or detailing we have provided, that will result in some capacity, and that we have to calculate in order to make a nonlinear model. And that capacity will be given in the nonlinear model as an input in the form of these curves. All curves will be nonlinear curves, the true relation between some of the actions and their corresponding deformations. So a nonlinear model will have these curves as an input, and that's what I mean by when I say that the code-based design will serve as an input for the performance-based design. So that nonlinear model will have the real capacities of all elements and will be able to simulate all the damages. For example, you know already that, okay, at material level, you know that this is where the cracking starts. This is where the significant cracking occurs. And this is where the degradation occurs and the material is going to fail ultimately. So we can call them as IO. We can call it as LS and then CP. And we know already from these curves that, okay, what is the capacity corresponding to IO, the capacity corresponding to LS, and the capacity corresponding to CP. Same is with other approaches of making nonlinear models. We know, for example, this is the IO curvature, LS curvature, and CP curvature. Or this is the IO rotation of the beam, this is the LS rotation, and this is the CP rotation. For these IO, LS, and CP, and these curves, different guidelines, as I have mentioned, one of them was ASCE 41, they help us in getting these capacities. And we input those curves in the nonlinear model along with these IO, LS, and CP numbers. And we perform first the service level evaluation here. And since the service level evaluation is at a earthquake level which is lower than even the design earthquake, so even the linear model can serve the purpose. And the linear analysis, for example, the response spectrum analysis, can serve the purpose. But for MCE evaluation, in which the structure can have significant nonlinear effects, you have to use the nonlinear model, this one which you have constructed here. And obviously, before performing the nonlinear dynamic analysis, you have to first select the ground motions and modify those ground motions according to the MCE level of hazard which you will be using for MCE level evaluation. And then you get the analysis results for both SLE and MCE levels, and then you assess those results and check the results with the acceptance criteria. Again, these acceptance criteria you have already put in the software in the form of IO, LS, and CP for each action and for each element. So the software should be able to directly give you the structural performance in terms of IO, LS, and CP after the analysis. And you check whether the performance is acceptable or not. These IO, LS, and CP requirements are fulfilled by each action and each element or not. And if it is not, then you have to change the original design. So the performance-based design is basically it is not the design process per se, just like the equivalent lateral force procedure or the RSA procedure. It is an assessment procedure for an initial design. Just like the conventional code based design uses a preliminary design or detailing or some initial member sizes, similarly the performance based assessment also uses an initial design but explicitly checks whether the design passes a certain performance requirement or not. And if it doesn't pass, we change the design whether it has followed some particular building code or not. Even if a design which is okay according to code based provisions and rules and limits may not be okay in performance based design. And in most of the cases, if the design has some flaws or if the design is not adequate or maybe over designed, maybe whatever is the actual performance of a particular design, you can get at the end. And it can be an iterative process that you can reduce some of the member sizes or reinforcement and the performance is still okay, then you can go with that reduced sizes or reinforcement. So the performance based assessment methodology can bring a significant amount of economy also in the structure. With this overview, let's look at each component separately and some of the issues which may arise in this methodology. The prerequisites for the PBD requirement, the very first thing is the basis of design, the description of building and structural system, the codes and standards, the loading criteria, material properties, modeling and design procedures, and the performance objectives and acceptance criteria. All of this should be agreed upon between the client and performance-based engineer. Once it is agreed upon that okay, these are the performance objectives and this is the acceptance criteria which should be checked after the analysis. You also need the site-specific probabilistic seismic hazard assessment if you don't have any information about the hazard level of the site, because the seismic loading in the performance-based assessment is defined in probabilistic framework. You must have SLE and DBE, for example, if you have to design the building also as part of this overall methodology, and MCE level. You must have their spectra, you must have the ground motion parameters and the hazard evaluation. For important buildings and projects, you can also go for the site-specific assessment. Because the traditional building codes, most of them, they do not provide the service level spectrum or service level earthquake hazard level. You also need geotechnical investigation in order to have some of the modeling decisions in that, and also some of the decisions related to the design of foundations. And in case of wind loading, you must also have a wind tunnel testing. This is a testing procedure which will give you directly the more realistic wind loading which should be applied to your computer model. So that wind tunnel testing is also performed for some important and high-rise building projects. So this performance-based specialist or engineer, he is supposed to work with the ordinary structural engineer or the original code-based designer. He is also supposed to work with the site-specific consultant and the performance-based design peer reviewer. Peer reviewer will check the performance assessment carried out by the PBD specialist. So this is an integral part of the PBD methodology, that you should also have a peer reviewer, and that peer reviewer should be a third party, you can say, engineer that should check the PBD and assessment done by the PBD specialist. And that peer reviewer will also report to the structural engineer, the original designer, and then all the stakeholders will be working together to come up with the final performance objectives, to meet those objectives set by the owner. Now, what are some special purpose guidelines which I was mentioning, which I use for PBD, and those should be followed? The very first thing about those that should be mentioned about them is that they are not building codes. They are not something which you should follow legally as part of a as part of the conventional design or part of the legal requirement. They are guidelines, and they can be used and can be followed with understanding. These guidelines can be from Applied Technology Council, ATC. For example, ATC 40 is one of the starting document for performance-based design, and it is one of the important reference for the first generation of performance-based design. Then we have documents from FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA 356, which was predecessor for ASC 41. Then we also have FEMA 273 and some other FEMA documents for performance-based assessment, NEHRP documents, peer guidelines, Pacific Earthquake Engineering Research by University of California, Berkeley. It is an organization, constituent organizations of UC Berkeley, and it has an initiative called Tall Buildings Initiative, TBI, and those TBI guidelines can be used in order to understand and apply some of the concepts of performance-based design. And then you can also have CTBUH, Council on Tall Buildings and Urban Habitat, guidelines for high-rise buildings and some of the important issues in the performance-based design of high-rise buildings. These guidelines can be found, most of them are freely available, especially the FEMA documents, the reports are available on their website, and NEHRP reports also. Peer reports and TBI reports are also freely available on internet, and you can check those documents. These are some of the views. And in these new generation of performance-based seismic design, the nonlinear analysis and the nonlinear dynamic analysis is at the core of this methodology now. So the first generation used nonlinear static analysis, the pushover analysis, but now we have the explicit nonlinear dynamic analysis. ATC 72 is also another important document, and that covers the modeling issues, the modeling and acceptance criteria for seismic design and analysis of tall buildings. Some of the other documents focus on some other issues about nonlinear analysis and modeling, so you can check them. The primary documents are these three: TBI document, and then this is a consensus document, an alternate procedure for seismic analysis and design for the tall buildings located in Los Angeles region. So this is also one of the primary sources of performance-based seismic design. And then we also have ASC 41, which gives us the capacity as well as the acceptance criteria. So the classification of elements and actions, as I was mentioning, the very first classification would be that we classify elements into primary components and also into secondary components. The primary components will have a force deformation behavior which may look like this, and the IOLS and CP for those primary components will not go beyond the degradation part in this part. So for primary components, the capacities are relatively lesser compared to the secondary components here. In secondary components, if you see here that the LS and CP are in the degrading part of the force deformation curve also. Now this action deformation curve can be anything. It can be stress strain curve, it can be moment curvature, moment rotation, it can be shear force versus shear deformation. Whatever action and deformation you want to make nonlinear in the nonlinear model, you have to give this a curve like this. So this classification is based on whether the component is part of the primary lateral force resisting system or not. For example, all the shear walls should be primary components. But for example, if the slabs and columns, interior frame can be considered a secondary component. Slabs are primarily designed to resist vertical load, gravity load. They can be considered as a secondary component. So the very first classification is primary and secondary. And then you also classify another set of classification on the actions within one element, whether an action is deformation controlled or force controlled. deformation controlled action should be ductile, and the behavior is ductile, and the reliable and elastic deformations can be reached with no substantial strength loss. So within one element you have to classify whether the shear should be a ductile action or it should be a brittle action. A ductile action can also be called as a deformation controlled action, and brittle action can be also called as a force controlled action. So for deformation controlled actions, the results are checked for mean value of demand from 11 set of ground motion records. The very first thing is that you should extract the deformation demands and compare with the deformation capacities. So for deformation controlled actions, the DC measure is in the form of deformations. For example, you will check whether the demand strain is less than capacity strain or not. The demand displacement or rotation is less than capacity displacement or rotation or not. You will not talk about forces here. And another point is that the latest guidelines of performance-based seismic design, they demand us to use more than one ground motion and perform the nonlinear dynamic analysis and take the mean value. So here, for example, the different guidelines propose different number. Previously, they were using 7 ground motion sets. Now they change it to 11 ground motion sets. So it depends on what guideline you are following or using, or what generation of performance-based design you are applying. So the deformation controlled actions will have a force deformation behavior like this, which will look like a ductile kind of a behavior. And obviously, when you define a particular action to be ductile, you will ensure actually in the design also, in the detailing and in the confinement also, that it should behave like a ductile action. So they both things go hand in hand. Obviously, you cannot define a deformation controlled action unless it is ensured in the actual practice, in the actual design, that it has a ductile detailing and it should be able to exhibit this kind of a behavior. So for brittle actions, the force deformation behavior will not be ductile. It will be simple brittle behavior that after attaining some peak value, it will simply go down. And different guidelines help us in getting these relationships for our different actions. So the behavior is more brittle in case of force controlled actions, and reliable in elastic deformations cannot be reached. Once that particular level of force achieved, then the structure is considered completely failed with no post yield capacity. No post yield capacity. Critical action is defined as the one which is likely to lead to partial or total structural collapse, and ordinary will be that the failure of which is either unlikely to lead to structural collapse or might lead to collapse, local collapse comprising not more than one bay in a single stroke. So you also have to define whether your action is critical or ordinary. So this table gives you an idea. For example, in case of shear walls, the actions can be flexure or shear. Now, you can define the flexural action as deformation control and shear action as a force control. This table is just a guideline from one of my colleagues in AIT Solutions from Thailand. For example, coupling beams, again flexure and shear. Maybe you can declare the flexural action as deformation control but shear as a force control. If the coupling beams have diagonal reinforcement, as I mentioned as part of one of the questions in last session, then even the shear can be made deformation controlled, because you have explicitly ensured that the shear behavior can sustain inelastic action. And some of them you can call as critical and some as not critical or ordinary, for example. So girders, again, you have flexure and shear. You can even make flexure and shear both has deformation control if you ensure actually that the shear behavior is going to be ductile. But actually, most of the time in girders, the shear behavior is not ductile, it is brittle. You have given the reinforcement such that it becomes a brittle behavior. So that's why you should keep the shear behavior as force controlled. And some other elements also, you can classify them as some of the actions. For example, in diaphragm you can have more actions, in mat foundations you can have more, similarly in piles also, and the list continues. The same, another kind of a guideline for you, that in case of axially loaded column, you can have axial flexural action time, because in columns axial load and flexural action are interacting each other, so that's why we cannot see them separately. Just like beams, we can do. In beams, the axial load is negligible, or at least less than 10% of the axial load carrying capacity of the cross section, so that's why we don't consider this interaction. But in columns, we can have, we should consider this axial flexural interaction, and we should treat this whole thing as one action. We can make it ductile by giving the actual nonlinear force deformation or action deformation curve for this action, but for shear maybe we can still classify it as brittle or force controlled. And same is for other kind of elements. You can find different tables in different guidelines. Some discussion about DC ratios, and we have already discussed it in last session, so I will quickly pass it through. So for example, DC ratios can be in terms of forces, and it can be in terms of deformations. So the total DC ratio of a member is combined of these two. Obviously you have to check both of these two DC ratios in order to decide about the performance of a particular element. So the primary output, or all the performances in the nonlinear analysis, will be checked in terms of these DC ratios after the analysis, whether an element was brittle or element was ductile, or whether it was having a force DC ratio or a deformation DC ratio. And then the elements are classified based on different ranges of these DC ratios for convenient visualization of structural damage and the available capacity, reserve capacity, whether the element is utilized well or not. Any decision making is done based on these DC ratios. So the capacity design concept can be employed as part of the performance based design philosophy, and I repeat again that the basic idea is that some component in the structure can safely be allowed to yield and others should remain elastic. So if we do not know which element should be allowed to yield and which we shouldn't allow to yield, we can use the analysis to tell us, but this will be a dangerous practice, because the analysis results can be significantly away from real structural behavior if we don't know about some of the prior concepts about nonlinear model and nonlinear behavior of the element. So the start of nonlinear modeling is not that straightforward that we just start declaring each action as nonlinear. We have to first anticipate the failure mode, and we have to equip the structural model that it should be able to mimic or represent all those failures which is possible as a result of some loading. So we can then design the yielding components to have sufficient ductility and the elastic components to have sufficient strength. So the deformation will be all plastic deformation will be concentrated in the yielding components, and therefore the structure will have adequate lateral yielding capacity. And advantages of using this approach will be that we will have more confidence on our nonlinear models. For example, if we have not obviously if we have not designed our certain element to remain to yield, we have designed it to remain elastic. In that case, we have to model it with an elastic behavior in the computer model also. So this will help us in setting up more reliable nonlinear models, the models with more realistic behavior capabilities. And then we can calculate more reliable DC ratios, and the final design is likely to be more forgiving. It can be more accurate, more realistic. For example, in case of frame structures, the capacity design approach will guide us that we can use the deformation DC ratios for beams in bending or for columns at base or at roof, but may not be used for columns in between. We can design them to remain elastic, and we can detail them to remain elastic. So we can use strength DC ratios or elastic components for columns, except the base and roof, and maybe connections can also remain elastic. We can also not allow any nonlinearity in beams and columns shears, and we can also not allow any nonlinearity in foundations, and they can also be elastic. For shear walls, for example, flexural hinging at base of the wall, you may not be able to understand this term now, but maybe we can allow the inelastic behavior at the base of the wall. Allow means that we can detail them, actually provide the reinforcement such that the ductility of those particular shear walls is significantly higher, and therefore in the modeling also they can be modeled with nonlinear force deformation behavior. Similarly, the shear in the coupling beams can also be made nonlinear, and their DC Meyer can also be deformation if they are provided with sufficient shear reinforcement. The remaining components should not yield, for example, the bending of walls in all others level except the base, because the base will be subjected to highest bending moments in case of lateral loads. So only the base components can be designed to yield. Obviously, the ductile elements require high cost. The shear reinforcement and other confinement requirements are costly. So we can follow them only at the base, and on the top we can design them as elastic to remain elastic, and we can model them as force controlled elements with force DC ratios. Shear in wall at all levels can be elastic or force DC ratios, and foundations can also. So the important point is that the only important results for performance assessment are these DC ratios, whether in the form of displacements or in the form of forces. And these DC ratios will guide us or tell us about the structural performance. So we have to define each component ourselves, its property, its capacities for IO, LS and CP. And in fact, by the way, in Perform 3D software, we are allowed to have 5 performance levels, not only 3 IO, LS and CP, but we can define our own performance level, which we can set according to our requirement or client's requirement. And at the end of the analysis, we can check which element or which action actually passed that performance requirement or not. But ASC 41 primarily talks about 3 primary performance levels, IO, LS and CP. So we have to try that our nonlinear model should be as much close to the real structural behavior as possible. So something about ASC 41, which was previously FEMA 356, and now the latest version is ASC 41-17, and it provides us the guidelines about performance-based design and seismic rehabilitation of existing buildings. The methodology, PVD methodology itself, can be applied to new buildings as well as existing buildings. You might have guessed already by now that it is a methodology to check a starting design whether it will pass the requirements set by the client or owner of the building or not, or any other decision maker. So it can be applied to new construction also, ASC 41, and it provides the guidance on modeling for nonlinear analysis. Basically, it provides us the force deformation curves, force versus deformation curves for each component and each action. And it also provides us the IO, LS and CP. So for example, in case of beams, let's say I require the moment versus rotation curve for modeling my beam. So obviously this curve will depend on how much reinforcement is there in the beam, how much shear reinforcement is there in the beam, how much is the concrete strength, how much is the other properties, dimensions of the beam, for example. So the ASC 41 provides us different tables in which we can use the initial properties of our beams and any other component, and it will give us this nonlinear force deformation behavior. So if you have ASC 41, you may not need to perform the lab testing of your actual beam and use it in the nonlinear model. You can rely on the capacities provided by ASE41 because that is based on extensive testing, and the tables and guidelines are developed after that. So it will not only provide you this curve for each action and each component, but also will tell you that what number should be IO and what number should be LS and what number should be CP. So it will give you these three numbers. For example, moment versus rotation for a beam, it will give you three rotations. And it will also guide you about how to construct this curve. It will tell you, for example, how much should be this distance, how much should be the next distance, some other guidelines about how we can construct this actual curve. And then on this curve, what numbers we should use as the capacities or as the acceptance criteria. So ASE41 is a comprehensive guideline for nonlinear modeling. And apart from that, we can also use ATC 72 and some other guidelines by NEHRP, for example, that also provide us some guidelines about nonlinear modeling of different elements. One important component of performance-based design is that when you use the material strength or capacity, you don't use the nominal strength, but you use the expected strength. Expected strength is higher than the nominal strength. For example, for reinforced concrete or, for example, steel, you should use the expected strength, which is higher than the nominal strength. So for concrete, the factor of 1.3 is specified in this report about PVD. And obviously, if your strength is 100, you should use 130, because the actual expected strength for all materials are always more than nominal strengths. In fact, nominal strength are the minimum strength of any sample, and the you can say that the actual strength is always more than that. So different guidelines are available to convert the nominal strength into expected strength. Since you are targeting the actual real nonlinear performance or behavior of the building, you don't require any safety factors. So no factor of safeties are applied in the inelastic actions. You explicitly modeling the nonlinear behavior, so no strength reduction factors, no you can say the load factors, for example. Yes, the components in the nonlinear model which will be modeled elastically, just like the elastic model, okay, the crack stiffness modifiers should be applied to those components. But in actions which are explicitly being modeled as nonlinear, there is no need to apply the crack stiffness modifiers also, because that effect of cracking, which you implicitly account using those factors, that is explicitly accounted for using the actual nonlinear curves which you have given the input. So only those crack stiffness modifiers will be applied to those components in the nonlinear model which are modeled elastically, which are force controlled. So these stiffness modifiers for elastic components, this is a summary table, for example, and different building codes provide different these factors for different levels of earthquakes, and different guidelines also provide these factors. So for different elements, you have these factors, and then you give them only to elastic components, not to inelastic components. So these are different for DBE level, different for MCE level, different for wind level or service level, and also different for some other loading. So the list continues, and we have different factors for each component. So this is a compilation by, again, Mr. Rong from AIT Solutions. So I duly acknowledge his effort in compiling these factors. Now, another important step is the analysis procedure to be used. We have already discussed that for service level earthquake, since the model used is mostly elastic, so the elastic analysis or the response spectrum analysis, for example, is enough. But for MCE level analysis, you have to have the nonlinear response history analysis. Previously, the pushover analysis was being used, this one, but now we have explicitly nonlinear dynamic analysis. So for example, if the behavior is essentially elastic, you have a regular structure, linear elastic procedure is fine. But for a regular structure with long periods or irregular structures, you may go for a dynamic analysis. If the behavior is inelastic, in that case, you can either use pushover analysis as part of the first generation of PVD, or you can go for the nonlinear dynamic analysis or the time history analysis that is necessary for MCE level evaluation, because in that case, significant damage is expected. So you cannot apply a nonlinear analysis procedure to a linear elastic model. That will be an erroneous approach. The ground motions, as I mentioned earlier, that previously the approach was that you should use 7 ground motions to perform nonlinear dynamic analysis, and you can take average of the peak responses and then use that average for any design decision making. But now the number is increased to 11. Acceptance criteria can be local, as I mentioned, that at each element level we have to check whether the element has reached to IO, LS or CP or not, and can be global also. So the local can be, for example, drift ratio, structural component deformation, whatever curve you have given as a nonlinear input curve, whatever is on the x-axis, you have to check what is the extent of that deformation. And global level also, there can be some acceptance criteria. For example, the limits on roof drifts, base shear can also be checked. So if you perform the analysis, what things you should check? For example, modal analysis results always, base shear and base moment comparisons, story shear and story moment, building sway and displacement, story drifts, and can be shear wall axial strains, local criteria, shear wall shear capacity, frame member rotations, their DC ratios, frame member shear strength and DC ratios, coupling beam DC ratios, slab diaphragm. Diaphragm is a special term, and I will define it in some other lecture or some other, you can say, session. But diaphragm can also be designed and checked after the analysis. And then overall damage, some weak points of the structure, some behavioral anomalies, if you can find from the nonlinear analysis. All of these things you should check for performance. So in order to give you an overview of what the acceptance criteria might look like, this is a kind of a summary table again from Mr. Ong, and that gives you an idea that how the service level criteria might look like. For example, the story drift, if it increases from 0.5%, you should declare that the structure is not serviceable, or it should not pass, it doesn't pass the service level criteria. The other expectations from the structure during the service level analysis are that the coupling beams, the shear strength to remain elastically, essentially elastic, the core wall flexure should remain elastic, the shear behavior in core wall should remain elastic, and some other criteria also. This can be local criteria for each element to check, and can be global also, as I mentioned earlier. These criteria are taken from different performance-based design guidelines, mostly from ASC 41 and some other guidelines which I introduced in previous slides. All the brittle actions are limited to DC ratio of 1, which means the structure should almost remain intact. Then the criteria should also include limits like no element, individual element, will be allowed to have a DC ratio of greater than 1.5. So you can say that, okay, the criteria is that no more 20% of the elements with ductile action having a DC ratio between 1 and 1.5. So if the elements which have more than 1 DC ratio, if their number increased to more than 20%, then you can declare that, okay, the service level limit is not passed. Okay, and then DBE level, you can have a classification of actions, and then the acceptance limit. So this is the acceptance criteria. It will be essentially consisted of numbers. The demand should be less than those capacities, or DC ratios should be less than the specified numbers. The MCE level criteria will be, now the story drift is allowed to go up to 3%. So if you can remember that for SLE level it was 0.5%, but now it can go up to 3% because the MCE level is a high level of an earthquake. Similarly, some other rotation limits you should check for each component, for each coupling beam, for each column. In this table, there is an example for buckling restraint braces also, BRBs. But the list will continue, obviously. This is just an example table which is compiled for the purpose of demonstration, that for each element you have to have an acceptance criteria, and that should be checked after the analysis. The tools of the trade which is required, obviously, if you are performing the linear elastic analysis, you can perform a linear analysis using ETABS or SAP. The ETABS 2016 onwards have some nonlinear modeling components also. So if you perform the collapse prevention check, you can go for Perform 3D, which is an explicitly a software explicitly for nonlinear analysis, and you can also use SAP 2000, but also now you can use ETABS 2016 up. 16, 17, 18 all have the nonlinear modeling and analysis capabilities. So these are some of the software from CSI, and you can use Perform 3D for nonlinear analysis. ETABS also now for nonlinear analysis, and ETABS can also be used to perform the linear analysis of building structures. So again, a final summary: you choose the performance level and design loads. You define the DC measure. You basically classify the elements. You classify the actions. Get the deformation and force capacities. Get the strength capacities, deformation capacities from different guidelines. Maybe strength capacities can come from traditional codes also, because codes are primarily based on strength analysis and design. So the strength capacities can also be calculated using code guidelines. But for deformation capacities, you explicitly need either ASC 41 or similar guidelines, or you perform your own test. Calculate the deformation and force demands, I mean perform the analysis and then get these numbers. And then you calculate DC ratios. If DC ratio is greater than 1, then either check the demand side of the equation and capacity side of the equation. So some example findings of PVD, for example. The shear wall flexure can be okay. This is just an example case, the summarized form of the PVD findings. The shear, about shear, for example, the finding can be that we should increase the horizontal reinforcement. The columns for shear, for example, again, we can say, we can find out that there is a requirement for increased horizontal reinforcement, and maybe column size also. For RC, again, we can have these, you can say, for specific RC elements, walls, we can have these kind of findings that we should increase confinement reinforcement in two stories, and we should increase horizontal reinforcement in these two stories for shear also. Then again, some other elements you can say that sometimes we need to increase longitudinal reinforcement, sometimes we need to increase horizontal reinforcement or shear reinforcement or confinements. The last component of this performance-based seismic design philosophy or analysis philosophy is peer review. I mentioned earlier also that a peer reviewer or a third-party company or a consultant should check, and it should also include some of the important concepts like how the hazard was determined, how the designer PBD engineer come up with these hazard values, ground motion characteristics, what is the seismic design methodology used, how the seismic performance goals are selected, the acceptance criteria is taken from what sources, is there any error in the modeling and simulation, and the seismic design and analysis results and design and specifications. So it is not a simple vetting process just like the conventional design. It is a more detailed peer review process in which whole seismic design assessment philosophy is checked. Then peer reviewer provides the written comments to engineer of record, and that engineer then again should provide the written responses to all of those comments, and the log is maintained and that summarizes all the comments, and those comments should be resolved at the conclusion of the review. Peer reviewer shall submit the references. The scope of the review includes the comment log and indicates the professional opinions of the peer reviewer regarding the design's general conformance to the requirements and guidelines in this document. So whatever was the agreed upon acceptance criteria between the client and the engineer of record or the performance-based design engineer, whether it is met or not, finally it is reviewed as part of the peer review process. So I will end this session here on one last thing, and that is the performance of non-structural components. According to a study that non-structural components can be as costly as 70 to 80% of the total cost of the building. So they account for more than 70% of the earthquake economic losses, and they are not really covered by the current procedures. So there are attempts nowadays to classify the non-structural components also, and to assess their performance also. So currently, in the latest performance-based design philosophy, the non-structural components performance is also part of the overall philosophy, is also part of the overall scheme, and that philosophy is extended to non-structural components also, especially, for example, the building contents and, for example, the masonry infills or some other elements which may not participate towards the structural performance, but their failure can significantly affect the consequences. So I will end this session here. My final recommendation would be that for new buildings, we can apply this design methodology, and for existing buildings, we can use this methodology as part of the performance evaluation to check whether the existing design is passing the explicit performance requirements set by the decision maker or not. So on this note, I will end this session, and I will continue this series with the discussion about nonlinear analysis and nonlinear modeling in the coming sessions. So see you there. Take care and thank you.